Yes. Good evening, my dear students. This is the continuation of research methodology and testing of hypothesis. Good evening. This is the continuation of research methodology and testing of hypothesis, part two. And in the previous video, I have discussed some of the basic concepts of research and its definition, and also regarding the purpose, and somewhere during the explanation of characteristics I've just stopped it. I just continue with the characteristics and I just move on. Here, if you say the characteristics, any research for that matter, it is going to be the result oriented in a logical sequence. And to say that any research for that matter, it should have a logical sequence, a beginning and an end, where all other activities or the sequences are going to be interrelated. Okay, just something like your project. And if you say the sequence are interrelated, and ultimately it's going to be one beginning and an end, and in the end it's going to be the conclusion and the remarks, and these conclusions again may be associated with that of your recommendations too. Ultimately, the characteristics of research should give you something in hand, something intangible, so that can be applied for your future reference, or maybe taking a kind of decisions. Maybe the results or conclusions may be in favorable of the preset objectives, or it may not. Results need not be always favorable with that of the objectives considered. Even it could be the other side of it too. Inventing or discovering or concluding, something is not true, something is not going to work out, something is not going to be feasible, something is not going to be considered for a kind of decision making or its future course of action, even that is also going to be conclusion. And always when it comes to research, many of the people, many of the researchers, many of the scholars, and many of the students are pursuing research, always see that hypothesis to be accepted, reject the hypothesis, and they'll come with a kind of biased mindset with regard to their conclusions. Here I mean to say that as a researcher, you should have unbiased mindset. Don't try to have any prejudiced conclusions. Don't try to have any kind of predetermined set of the conclusions in your mind, and let us allow the research to take its own course of natural action. Let it be maybe favorable, or even it could be unfavorable. That is what is called as even the ethics part of research too. Next, research involves the quest for answers to unsolved or partly solved problems. Maybe kind of problems and the kind of crisis kind of situations we can go for improving the solutions, improving the quality of life, improving the kind of solutions that are going for, maybe kind of upgradations, updates, and all these things could be your conclusions. This is what exactly research is all about. Research is not about something to be stagnated. It's a continuous process, it is dynamic in nature. It is going to have the never ending process. This never ending, you will say, maybe it could be with regard to unsolved problems, or maybe it could be the problems which are partially solved. Now, research also requires a kind of courage, patience, and no excuses. Always people say that, you should start gaining courage to be more patient, and also see that all our excuses are thrown out, and I say that put it to somewhere near the dustbin, and okay, don't carry with your excuses while going to meet your research supervisors or PhD guides or your professors or maybe a kind of any okay consultations, whatever it may be. Okay, excuses to some extent or to the large extent, I can say, to be it is best to avoid. Next, research is characterized by it is unhurried activity. It is a continuous long journey. Okay, minimum the PhD guidelines say that there is a minimum of 5 or 7 years to say. Therefore, it is say that it is an unhurried activity. It you should allow research to take its own course of action. Okay, and don't try to suffocate. Don't try to suffocate either the conclusion or the process or the kind of activities that are supposed to be carried in while going for your research. Next. Research is carefully recorded, published, and reported. And that's what I can say. I say that documentation side. Research always should speak about, I can say, the legitimate recording and publishing work, and even that should be made available to the public domain. And always see that your work is documented. Documentation in the sense, the purpose is to say that that should be there for your future reference. Your work should be there either in cloud form or maybe in soft form or maybe in any of the written format, whatever it could be. Okay, you see that is documented, either maybe a electronic document or maybe a printed document, whatever it may be. See that it is carefully recorded. There's a legitimate proper guidelines to go for how exactly research work is going to be published or reported in the sense that should be made available to the public reference, and see that is put into your public domain. Next, there are two basic types of research. If you say two basic types of research, one is based on the deductive reasoning and one is based on your inductive reasoning. And all these things, deductive and inductive reasoning, already explained in my previous class itself. Okay, if you say deductive reasoning, it starts with the theory and ends with the confirmation. And I have given an example, cow eats grass, and it may not be same always. And the same problem of cow eats grass or not, okay, can also be taken with the help of your inductive reasoning. And okay, you start observing the cows in the street, and the farm on the outside, and say that okay, how exactly okay they go with this, that I can say food habits or eating habits. And generally we say that cow eats grass, but there is a cow, there are few cows, okay, they eat grass at the same time something else, some garbage too. Therefore, okay, you can disprove the earlier theory that cow eats grass. Cow eats not only. This is the kind of research, either it could be inductive or deductive reasoning, observations and theory. And earlier theory is that cow eats grass. The next theory is that you can say that cow eats not only grass but something else. This is based on your inductive and deductive reasoning. Inductive reasoning, start with observations. Okay, part by part, bit by bit. Okay, I can say tiny by tiny units and kind of things. And there, you're going to study the patterns, how the behavior is observed. And based on that, a tentative hypothesis is formed, and you're going to have the new theories evolved. Okay. If observations are used to develop new theories, that is going to be inductive reasoning. Or okay, if you say that if the confirmations are based on the pre-existing theory, that is going to be your deductive reasoning. Okay, just you can have a comparison of deductive and inductive reasoning. The research could be of any of these two categories. Next, types of research continuation. I can say it is called as qualitative research, quantitative research, and mixed research. Generally, okay, it's about your qualitative and quantitative research. And here I've stopped circadian rhythm. Circadian rhythm is all about, the one which speaks about, early risers, who rise early, who start their work very early in the early morning. Okay, now, Okay, there was a research claiming that the one who rise start their work early, okay, maybe 4 o'clock in the early morning, maybe somewhere around in the 5 o'clock or 5:30, maybe during that in the morning hours, very early morning hours, these people are going to have good kind of immunity power. And there is a very less research supported to say that, okay, whether COVID-19 circadian rhythm, okay, it can be related or not. That's just my example, my thought, I can say. Okay, you cannot take my thought and you can have different examples too, okay, to describe or to go for a basic kind of research. I can say there's a theory that says that your immunity is based on your circadian rhythm. And you have to prove it. And the same thing can be applied to study the COVID-19 and the immunity related aspects. Next is going to be exploratory research, okay, where it is going to investigate a problem which is not clearly defined, partly defined, or yet to be defined. All these things, okay, you are going to be the beginner, you are going to be the one who is going to select the journey which is less traveled by, I can say. And this is exploratory research is going to have the better understanding of the existing problem, but will not provide any conclusive results. It all based on the amount of work that are going to carry with. Okay, you may end up with only a bit of the contribution, not as a whole, not as a complete, not as a comprehensive solution. Okay, that's what exactly exploration. And exploration in a long way, exploration in a long journey, exploration in its continuation, maybe, okay, decades after, people, the collective effort of people, collective effort of the researchers, collective effort of the one who are going to contribute to the field, okay, that may give you, okay, a kind of concrete results. This is what exactly exploratory research. This is, again, a continuous process. Now, for such a research, researcher starts with general idea, and that has to be carried with, associated with the issues, and it also should focus on the future research work. Now, next is about action research. Action research is all about a kind of basic research which aims at providing immediate solutions for a problem. Generally, as far as my knowledge goes, action research is largely used in the area of education, okay, the educational experts to design their pedagogy, to design their different teaching methods, effective teaching, and to deal with the problem with the students of slow learners, as well as go for effective classroom interaction and all these things. Okay, you can have the different tools and techniques supporting aids, so that this problem of slow learning or ineffective classroom interaction that can be solved by using this action research as an approach. Next. Okay, we have diagnostic research, evaluative study and all, but if say diagnostic research, okay, it's all about diagnosing that particular problem, okay, which is having the interactive effort with regard to your dependent and vulnerable cause and effect relationship. And generally, this diagnostic research is used by majority of the medical professionals and all. Next, I'm not going to discuss all these things in at stretch because, I can say it, one is the matter of time and other is the heavy literature that is available with regard to your this kind of types. Research. Next is, I can say, the kind of studies, if you say that, there are two types. One is cross-sectional studies, longitudinal studies. Okay. And if you say cross-sectional, the research at one point of time. Okay. You have 4 or 5 years of duration and are going to conduct the survey just once, maybe during the period of 2019. July to December, 6 months. That is your study time. That's it. And you're not going to continue this study for any time later of this time. Now, this is going to be your cross-sectional study. Longitudinal, this Okay, you are going to have the study at several points of time, the same particular group, the same kind of consumers, the same kind of the control group samples are observed, and you are going to have the kind of conclusions based on is there improvement, okay, as the time scale changes. But here, okay, we are going to have different samples, different geographical locations, but here longitudinal, same geography and the same sample, but observed on different time scales. It could be drug administration, drug research, or maybe any kind of policy and its impact, and I can say social stigmas and their changes on the culture and beliefs of a particular society, or maybe a particular kind of product launch and test marketing. And I'm going to study the consumer preferences, or maybe their kind of updations with regard to the kind of products that are going to be released time to time. Maybe it's kind of for a period of 2 or 3 years, gradually on a periodical base of maybe 3 months or 6 months, the same particular group is observed based on the changes of the features of the product. If that is the case, it's going to be longitudinal study. Generally, okay, we go with this cross-sectional aspect. Next, descriptive and the survey method is used in the cross-sectional, and in the case of longitudinal, okay, we are going with clinical trials, laboratory experiments, I said drug research and wildlife studies. See, wildlife studies, if you want to study the behavior of the wild animals, okay, select a particular wildlife demography and try to observe, okay, their kind of behavior, the wildlife animals and their behavior, okay, on different scales of time. And even you can have the control group its samples, and that can be compared with two. This is going to be longitudinal studies. Experimental group and control group, and you can study over a period of time. This is your longitudinal research. Next, research design. Okay, research design speaks about the structure or outline or blueprint of your research report. How exactly you are going to structure it? You say documentation and research. Okay, this documentation, okay, should have a proper structure of the research, and this structure of the research, okay, they're going to be with these kind of contents. Okay, this is as per the general guidelines of any university for that matter. This is what exactly we speak about. It starts with introduction. The introduction is going to be historical perspective and the conceptual study of the problem and the statement. Okay, the problem statement comes out of your literature study. Okay, and its gap too. Okay, once you complete your literature study and identify the gap, we are going to have your research questions. And these research questions are, okay, neatly framed or established as your problem statement. Why if you say that, why a problem statement is required? Because when you say that framing of your objectives and hypothesis, okay, your objectives and hypothesis should be in line with that of your problem statement as well as gap of the literature gap. That for that reason, okay, this problem statement is very much important. I'm giving you in general sense of how it could be your research design. Next, okay, it is a statement of the problem. The statement of the problem should be well defined with regard to that of the literature and earlier research and the present research and the kind of research that you're going to carry out, and how exactly are going to do justice for your the gap that is going to be identified. The research problem should also focus on the importance of your research, why it is going to be carried out, and even you can say that, okay, it could be need of the research and relevance of the research, scope of the research, all these things could be, okay, used while formulating your research problem. Next, if you say objective of the study, okay, these are all in line with our research question as it is stated earlier. Okay, Your research questions for which answers are sought are framed in the form of the objectives. Okay, and generally, for the sake of making the research simple and more comprehensive, okay, even to make it presentable for even for a layman, see that the number of objective statements are curtailed, limited, maybe 5 or 6. Okay, it is not advisable, it is not sensible to go for more number of objectives. Say, okay, you can have any number of objectives that is left to you, but generally it is best advised to go for 5 or 6 objectives, okay, based on your problem statement. It's not wise enough to go for more than 6 objectives. Okay, it's not good to also because you're going to lose your focus. Okay, that's what the problem is. And that whatever the objectives that you are intended to include, okay, the extension part I'm telling you, the same can be used to I can say mention in your further scope or future scope of the research. And that is maybe a scope for or I can say for your further research too. You are going to give a way for your next research. Next is hypothesis of the study. The hypothesis are framed or established based on objectives. Generally, there are a few guidelines to be taken into account. Generally, hypothesis is a kind of tentative proposal which is developed to study either the possible relation or the association or the kind of differences of opinions among the selected variables. As you use the different terminologies, in the case of hypothesis and hypothesis testing, you're going to have different tests. Say the statistical test, generally, we learn more about the chi-square test, t-test, vector analysis, and even some kind of models, having the best fit of the model and all. If you say the ranking kind of data, if the data is ranked based on maybe 10-point scale or maybe 5-point scale, whatever it may be, it all depends on the ranking, qualitative skills. Then even you can go for Friedman's rank test, or you have the sample very much limited, lesser sample, limited sample. Even you can go for Mann-Whitney U test. There are several of such kind of tests. You need to have the bit of awareness, how the statistical tests can be used while going for hypothesis. Even this hypothesis testing should also be taken in accordance with the type of the scale that you're going to use. If you are using only dichotomous scale, only yes or no, it is best advised to go for your chi-square test. Or if you are using Likert scale or ranking scale, it is advised to go for either t-test or vector analysis or ANOVA and kind of things. And why I'm telling you is that, the hypothesis and its testing are basically developed based on the scale of measurement. Qualitative scale of measurement cannot be tested by using a statistical test which is meant for quantitative scale of measurement, or vice versa. Therefore, you should be sensible enough in selecting the kind of tests too. And for that, you need to have a better understanding of the statistical tests too. People say that chi-square, if you are supposed to go for a chi-square test, people think of applying t-test. When you are supposed to go for a t-test, people come and ask, is there chi-square is possible? See, chi-square and t-test are basically two different things. Chi-square is we call it as a non-parametric test, whereas t-test is called as a parametric test. And you should have all such basics, and then you can go for having hypothesis and its testing. Next, review of literature is there, and this is the compulsory part. Why to add literature survey or review of literature? That makes you more courage, more knowledgeable, and that will be exposing yourself to the kind of work that has been already taken place, and you'll be better knowing about your research problem. and to gain more knowledge, to have better inroads into a research problem, okay, it is suggested to have more kind of such literature review. It is better to have, okay, whether how much you add into your research report, that is that cannot be addressed here, but what I suggest to say is that, okay, better to have some 100 plus literature review, okay, before starting your documentation work. Okay, 100 plus, and out of this 100 plus, you can select the latest, you can select the recent ones, and you can select the most relevant ones, but better to go for 100 plus literature review, okay, before starting with any of the research work. Okay, it is advised that you should have the basic understanding of the problem and its most, in and out of your research should be known. And the one and only way, okay, that gives you the in and out of your research work is your literature review or survey of literature. And this is the most important one. Okay, you need to have rigorous, thorough, continuous reading of the earlier research works. That is what exactly it is prescribed for all of the students of research. Next, conceptual background and scope of the study. Okay, you should have the conceptual clarity of any research. This conceptual clarity can be developed based on your conceptual background. And once you have the conceptual background is cleared, you can go with the scope. And this scope, it is used to have the better logical connection of the variables. And also, you can have the proposed conceptual models can be developed. The existing models can be developed. And once you have the conceptual background is better understood, okay, you are going to have the limitations or the whole limitations of the study can be developed, because no research is 100% perfect. And there are few limitations, and I say that limitation should be there for any of the research. Okay, you are not the ultimate, and you are not, I can say, the last one to say, because there is enough scope to continue, and wherever there's a limitation, and these limitations can be mentioned in your further scope, and that can be used to mention your future scope of research. Next, the significance, why this particular research is taken forward, and who is going to benefit this, and what is the value addition that we are going to give, okay, whether maybe to the academics, or maybe to your students, or maybe to the industry, or maybe to the corporates, or maybe to the policy makers. Okay, why it is required, what is the significance of this study, and where you are going to add value, and this value addition makes you more significant. And there are majority of the researchers, both in the pure sciences and social sciences, where the different policies are developed based on the significance and relevance of the study. And you can do the Google search and say that, okay, which are all the research and the projects that are accepted by the different funding agencies, or maybe the academic bodies or the policy making institutions, okay, to help their state administration and quite of such things. Next, research methodology. This is one more thing to be added here. This is, there are specific type of the methods to be added. What type of method that you're following? And here I have mentioned a series of methodologies here. Okay, types of research. What type of research that you're following? And again, you can say why you have selected this particular work. And based on this types or methods of research, okay, your methodology is going to formulated. Now, based on this research methodology, we are going to select the type of the data collection. Generally, people go with survey, people go with observations, people go with secondary data, people go with the laboratory experiments and all. And okay, whatever that you select, that should be justified. You cannot just say that blindly, I'm going with survey, or I just go with observations, I go with experiments. That should not be there. But you see that how good you are going to justify your methodology. And that justification comes out of the logical sequence of development of your conceptual background and scope of the study, even literature, and how you have formulated your objectives and hypothesis of the study. All these things are going to give you, the better understanding of, okay, how you are going to have your methodology fine-tuned, and so that it is justified. Next, data analysis and interpretation, and this is the most critical part of the many of the people who say, there are different statistical techniques and technical techniques, and there are different statistical programs, softwares available to analyze your data. And why I'm telling you is that, okay, the days are gone just to put your analysis in just percentage and simple charts, because inferential statistics is playing a major role in going for, in giving your conclusions and suggestions. And once you say that inferential statistics, okay, that's all about, okay, using your inferential statistical techniques. And if there's statistics and descriptive and inferential statistics, descriptive statistics is used to have a kind of percentages and the descriptive kind of charts and diagrams. But inferential statistics is largely used to have generalizations of the study. Generalizations comes out of your hypothesis testing, and hypothesis testing calls for your statistical techniques to be used. Then only, okay, it could be 95% of level of significance, or 95% of level of confidence, or 99% of level of confidence. All these things are going to give you added value to your research. Okay, even it could be based on simple percentages and all, that is not a matter. But okay, because of the changing trends and the generalization perspective, hypothesis testing and analysis and interpretation plays a major role. Next is about findings, discussions and recommendations. It's all about summary of findings, and people may not have basically when it's sent to evaluation and examinations and evaluation purposes, people may not have sufficient time to study all their chapters together. Okay, they may focus only on summary of findings and its conclusion as the last chapter, and that's what exactly you're going to comprehend, and you're going to summarize, and you're the complete chapter 1 to chapter 5 or 6, and they're going to have this summary of findings, and based on the summary of findings you can go for conclusions and future scope of research. Basically, the summary of findings is the most critical part of it, and you should have the better control on your writing. Okay, writing is a skill. You can talk whatever you want, you can speak whatever you want, you can read whatever you want, but at the same time, if you want to pen it down and if you want to write it down, okay, there should be, it is a kind of special skill. Okay, writing and reporting is a special skill. I can say that, okay, you may take some more good time to understand how exactly a thesis of some 300 or 250 pages can be brought down to a simple writing of 10 to 15 pages, because summary of findings and discussion part, maximum it can be extended up to 25-30 pages, and all your work of 250-300 pages to be summarized, and that should be written in a compact manner, very lucid manner, okay, very simple form, okay, so that any reader should understand that. And that's what about the structure and the contents and the design part of the research is. Next is, okay, it is my presentation, to continue with, I focus more on the social science side of it, because I belong to the same category. Okay, social science research, okay, basically focused on human behavior modification and social life. Okay, you can relate IQs and EQs and SQs. Okay, as per your Herbert Gardner's concept, there are multiple intelligence levels. And all these multiple intelligence levels of human beings are with respect to the society and the human behavior. And any such kind of research that is focused on human behavior and the level of intelligence and the level of interaction and the level of understanding the social side of any human being or any organization okay, can be called as, can be treated as the social science research. And as an example, I've just quoted it. Next, it seeks to find explanations to unexplained social phenomena, and even to verify the doubtful and misconceived facts of social life. Okay, social, there are so many misconceived facts of social life, because everything comes out of the social understanding, or quite a kind of misunderstanding, misconceptions. And how to eradicate or limit or minimize such kind of misconceptions or doubtful human behaviors is only through the social science research part. Next is with the social sciences, I have taken a few things from the textbook. This is social sciences engage in the scientific study of human behavior. The study of human behavior, okay, at a particular setup with respect to any organization, any market, any company, any organization, whatever it may be, that is your social sciences. Okay, study of human behavior at an organization, at a well established setup. Now it could be with regard to social interaction, social groups in society, and all these things comes out to be our social science research. Next, the social science research can be extended to the streams of disciplines, the kinds of the various faculty of disciplines, I can say economics, sociology, psychology, anthropology, political science, cultural studies, commerce and management. This is the whole group of disciplines where you can think of applying social science research. Basically, okay, you can go for descriptive or experimental survey or experimental research or kind of survey, and generally you go with cross-sectional. Okay, it doesn't mean that you're not going to apply a longitudinal. Even it could be longitudinal surveys. When you say psychology and anthropology and human evolution and the political science and the policy implications, okay, you can go for the longitudinal studies too. Studying a particular group of people, okay, on different time intervals, okay, having some controlled setup and variations in that controlled setup, and all these different variations on a particular group of people. Even it could be, I can say, there is something called a tribal studies, and that this tribal studies and sociology and psychology and anthropology can be combined together, and the tribal studies can be done based on your longitudinal experiments, longitudinal studies. Okay, next, this is the research cycle. How exactly it starts? It starts with a problem. I said, as you can remember my the first slide, there should be a problem. Problem means there should be this kind of, no, the curiosity. It starts with a problem, then it goes through a cycle of events. Okay, this is about a cycle of events, I can say. This is once problem is done, then objectives, then research strategy, design, literature review, and this follows this cycle, and here exactly it concludes. Findings, summary of findings and conclusions. Next, if you say the social science research and to collect data and to study the different establishments, the tribal people and the human beings, if you say, okay, all these things are very much largely available. We call it as a population. But when you say, when you have a vast population, vast kind of data is available. Okay, the scientific part of collecting data is about get a sample of it. There is a very beautiful science and statistics that is there to address the issues of sampling. And one needs to know what is sampling and why the sampling is required for a sampling frame. And all these things are addressed in my next slide. Okay, if it's a sample, it is a systematic process of selecting a particular group of people or a sample, okay, from an entire population. When you say the sample is selected, there is one particular important characteristic feature to be addressed that is called as representativeness. That representativeness to be addressed. Okay. If you say the representativeness to be addressed, you have to go for a scientific way of collecting data, that is your probability sampling. And why sample, if you say that? If you go for the whole census kind of survey, it takes a lot of time, resources, time and money. And the only way to minimize all your resources and all your time, money and the workload by going for your sample. The sample minimizes your effort but maximizes your results. That is what exactly I can say. Your optimization can be achieved. Okay, research optimization can be done with the help of sample and the selection of the best sample, selection of your representative sample, that can be done. Here we say that, okay, your research and accuracy levels may be estimated at 95% to 99% of level of confidence. And I have given this number, even you can extend the accuracy level up to 99.9724%. I can say at less than 1% of level of significance. Okay, I am talking about something very much sensible with regard to your one-tail and two-tail tests of your statistical inferences. Okay, if you say two-tail test, okay, your I can say the critical area is going to be very much minimum. This 100 minus 99.9724, okay, whatever that you get little, that is shared among the two tiles of a normal distribution curve equally, and that is what exactly are rejecting area, the area that is going to be rejected, and that is very much less in its percentage. And we call the same phenomena is used to address your total quality management and even process capability index. Okay, having your statistical process control and quality control in place, where okay, you have large amount of industrial applications too. Okay, that is a different discussion altogether. That is, these things can be addressed. Okay, if I take up total quality management, okay, as a part of completely. Next, sampling frame. Sampling frame is a list from which the potential respondents are drawn from. Okay, it could be our market segments, demographics, students, children, parents, doctors, housewives, academicians, and all these things. Next, look at this. This is what exactly I meant to say. This is sampling, population, sampling frame, and this sample. And whole from the whole population, I'm going to have a sampling frame. And from this sampling frame, I'm going to sample. And here, what is called as sample size. The N should be decided. What is the value of N? And there is a scientific way of designing it N also. And if we say this sampling frame, the sampling frame may be all the students, okay, from this population. The population may be entire Karnataka. Entire Karnataka, the students are pursuing their college education. If we say college education, it could be for post-graduation and it could be undergraduation and even the higher studies too. And your sampling frame should be, you know, rigidly defined, whether you're going for only undergraduate students, postgraduate students.